May we live simply by reliance on the power of the holy name of Allah, who is complete love, overflowing with compassion and grace. May our spontaneous praise and gratitude be directed to Allah alone, the ultimate source of the unfolding of all worlds, Allah, who is complete love, overflowing with compassion and grace, and who is master of the spiritual discipline of all beings, bringing them all to their time of truth. Only to you, O Allah, do we offer the full commitment of our lives, and from your infinite power alone do we seek the strength that we need. Lead us not along the circuitous paths of those who are wandering away from their source, but lead us along the direct path to the highest illumination, the path of return traveled by those saints and sages who have been blessed by awakening fully into your holy presence. Ya Allah. Ya Allah. Ya Allah. Good morning. This is Lex Hixon. The program is Body, Mind, Spirit. The words you heard were an English translation of the Fatiha, the first surah of the Quran, which is roughly speaking the Lord's Prayer of Islam. It's a prayer repeated around 40 times every day as part of the ordinary 5 times daily prayer of every Muslim. And I hope you could feel and understand the richness and depth of the spiritual insight in that prayer. And you can imagine what it can fill one's life with. We have with us in the studio this morning Shaykh Muzaffer Effendi from Istanbul. And he and his dervishes have been paying a visit to New York and have been performing the ancient ceremony of zikr, divine remembrance, at various places in the city. They've recently been at St. John the Divine Cathedral on Thursday, last night, and again the previous Sunday night. And they're going to be here next week also, this time in downtown, and will be on March 31st, that's Monday, at 7:30 p.m., at New York University, at Tishman Auditorium, Vanderbilt Hall. And there's going to be no seating after 7, so please be there by 7 on Monday evening. And then April 2nd at 8 p.m. at Cooper Union, the Great Hall at Cooper Union. And there will be no seating after 7:30. There's no charge at all for these. It's a way of sharing some of the rich ancient traditions of Islamic culture, particularly the mystical traditions, because the Shaykh, although he is an imam, he is a representative, a pure representative of the orthodoxy of Islam. He is also a dervish sheikh, a Sufi master who is the 19th sheikh in a succession of dervish masters, going back to the Pir Nuruddin Jerrahi, who passed away in 1721. So we want to talk this morning with the Shaykh just informally about various issues, spiritual issues, and he's going to be coming on next Wednesday to speak about matters of political interest, such as the situation in Iran and the role of Islam in the world. But today, since it's Friday and our theme is sacred traditions, we want to explore some spiritual questions with him, although all the questions do interlock with each other. He's going to be, after the show, he's going to be at the Noor Oriental Gallery down on 5th Avenue on 30th Street. It's the address is 1 West 30th Street. So If you're interested, you can come and continue the conversation with him there and have a cup of tea with him. He's don't feel shy to come. He speaks Turkish, and you'll hear an English translation, but he speaks also with the language of the heart and speaks very directly. So anyone would be welcome to come this afternoon from 2:30 to 4:30 to the Newer Oriental Gallery, 1 West 30th Street, Suite 201. It just so happened that Mary Houston, who many of you know, does a Saturday morning program on food, was here at BAI in the studio in the reception area, and she was asking some questions to the Shaykh, and had opened up some very interesting issues, and I just wanted to have her, just in the spirit of this informal conversation, I just wanted to have her ask her question again, and so because they were just talking when we were about ready to come on the air, and I didn't want to break the flow of the conversation. It was a beautiful conversation. So, Mary Houston, can you make your...
Well, one of the things that I was wondering about is during times that I have meditated, there are some times that I can directly get close to the divine source or divine love, and I can feel it, and I can feel it the rest of the day. And there are other times when I'll go into meditation and I can feel a connection, but it's not as close and not as deep. And I wanted to know what the reason for that was, why it happens that sometimes when you meditate you can connect immediately or after a little while and have this incredible feeling of divine love, and at other times you can meditate for a long, long period of time and not reach it at this with the same intensity.
Dışarıda söylediği suali şimdi radyoda tekrarlatıyorlar.
Evet.
Niçin istihareye oturduğum zaman bazen hemen kalbim ruhaniyetle doluyor.
Evet.
Bazen uzun müddet bu olmuyor.
İşte o şahsın gördükleri ve işittikleri ve yedikleri ve efali ve akvali bu iş üzerine tesiri vardır.
This has great deal to do with your intake of food, precisely, which we didn't know was your field of interest. But of course, Effendi extends the idea of food as absorbed not by the mouth alone, but breathed in, heard, tasted, eaten, seen, acted. In fact, you see, your actions and their reactions are a part of the food which enters your system. And all these influence one, whether one is quickly accepted to the presence of Allah or one is rejected from the presence of Allah.
Hatta bazı zevaatı görür yahut gördüğü kişinin nazarına uğrar, onun dahi insan üzerine tesiri olur.
There is also the question of other people's feeling about you. For instance, we really believe in the eye which falls on you. You see, of the goodwill of the eye, or of the, for instance, jealousy in the eye, you see, which sees you. All these may be responsible for your state.
Hatta en önemlilerden bir tanesi de budur, yani nazar meselesi.
And in fact, one of the most important reasons of the occurrence of this situation is the question of nadar, let's say the eye, which falls on you.
May I ask a question now that you mention that? Does he think that you yourself are responsible for the eye of the other person?
Siz diyor, yani evet. Nazarın üstüne düşen kimse mesul mü diyor o kimsenin size nazar etmesinden?
Mesuliyetlisi var, mesuliyetsizi var.
Yes, there is some cases that one is responsible and there is some cases when one is not responsible.
if you were coming from a place of divine love most of the time or all of the time, then I thought that then people couldn't look at you with hostility or jealousy, but only if you were coming, but if you started to come through sometimes through your ego or a negative place, then you could be responsible for that.
Eğer sizin hatta harekatınız müsbet ise, eğer kalbinizde Allah sevgisi ve Allah aşkı var ise, o zaman diyor bu sizi müdafaa etmez mi fena güze karşı? Ve sizin hatta harekatınız fena ise ve menfi ise, bu da nazarı üstünüze çekmez mi diye soruyor.
Şimdiki nazar iki kısım. Bir nazar var, rahmet nazarı var. Şefkat ve sevgi nazarı var. Bir de haset ve kötülük nazarı var.
You see, there are obviously two sorts of sight which falls on one. One is the sight of love, of mercy and compassion. And the other one is the sight of arrogance, of envy and of hypocrisy.
Bir de hilkat bakımından kötü nazarlı kişiler var.
And then there are also people by creation, they have got poisonous eyes.
İşte az evvel söylediğim gibi, Hazreti bir şeyh bir huzura geldi, orada dervişleri var idi, oturdu fakat kendisinde kabız hali var, yani açılmıyor göğünü. Ve sordu oraya, burada içimizde yabancı kimse var mı? Dediler ki, yabancı kimse yok ama sabahleyin bir adam geldi buraya, bastonunu, asasını burada bıraktı. Gitti, o kadar. O asayı dışarı çıkarın dedi. Ve asayı dışarı çıkardılar. Şeyhin kalbi açıldı ve kabus hale gitti, bas hale geldi kendisine.
You see, this thing extends further even. And our Shaykh has told a story that there was once a Shaykh and they had gathered like we are here as a group. But there was a terrible case of restriction of the heart, that nothing happened. No love flowed, no spirit flowed into the hearts of people. And then he turned around and he said that, is there anybody present here which is not one of us, which has come new? And they said, no, there is nobody which is not one of us. Except one of them said that this morning we had a visitor who left his walking stick here. And when this walking stick was taken out with the orders of the Shaykh, everything went back to normal.
Bir adam ne kadar iyi olsa, meydan-ı muharebede düşmanın kurşundan kurtulamaz. Meğer kendi iyi müdafaa eder. Şimdiki bir adamın iyi olması, kötü adamın nazarından kendisini kurtaramaz. Ancak bir silah olması lazım ki onu karşılasın. O silah da nedir? Duasıdır, Allah'a sığınmasıdır.
You see, in a field of battle, no matter how wonderful and pure and clean a soldier is, this pure heart of the soldier and his wonderful actions and his wonderful past life could hardly protect him from the bullets coming from the enemy. And life sometimes is like that. The only defense, the only shield which you have is the protection of Allah and the mercy of Allah, which you receive in turn with your attachment to Him, with your closeness to Him, with your prayers to Him.
Gördüğü, gördükleri ve yediklerinden bahsetmiştim az evvel, tesiri olur diye. Bunların hepsine misal vereceğim şimdi.
I had mentioned to you that what you see, what you hear, what you eat had influences on you. And I will give you some examples of that.
Evvela yediğinden bahsedeyim.
Let me talk about food a little bit.
Çünkü ilk görüş, yedi, bakması, dinlemesi, bunlar ufak bir şey görülür fakat bir tohum toprağa atıldığı vakitte nasıl ki çoğalırsa insan vücudunda öyle çoğalabilir.
What one perceives, one's perceptions, the single word which one hears, mouthful of food which one swallows, one may think that those are very small things and would not affect one, but they are like a seed which is thrown inside the earth, and in one's system that increases.
Güzel bir adamla karşılaşırız. O adam biliyorsun kalbi çok temiz bir insandır, temiz. O gün insanın işi rast gider.
For instance, how often it has happened that one sees a beautiful person, and with this influence, although it's just a mere sight, with this influence that one's whole day turns out to be a beautiful day.
Kalbi elinde olmayarak bir neşe içerisinde o gününü geçirir.
That the day becomes a happy day, and one's heart is open to everything which surrounds one.
Mesela bir misalini veririm şimdi, bir yani komprim olarak, hikaye olarak anlatıyorum. Bir kötü adamı, çok kötü bir insanı o devrin mahkemesi idama mahkum etti.
Here is a story which will perhaps clarify the situation. That a terrible criminal who has committed all the sins which you can imagine, the court of that time condemned him to execution, to death.
Ve onu infaz ettiler, hükmü astılar.
And they hung him.
Ve onu şehrin ortasına astılar ki gelip geçen onu görsün, ibret alsınlar, kötü kişiler ibret alsınlar diye.
At those times the executions were public so that people would take lesson.
Çünkü bazı insanlar ancak böyle şeyi görürlerse ibret alabilirler. Manevi asılmanın farkına varmazlar. Maddi olarak görürlerse anlayabilirler.
Some people have to be shown such horrors. Some people have to be kicked to understand. There are very few people who are able to observe spiritual hangings and moral hangings. They have to see material hangings and punishments.
Çünkü her eşya konuşmaktadır. Ama anlayan için.
Everything which exists, every matter which exists, are speaking.
Ama
anlamayan, but who hears them?
Anlamayan ancak konuşur anlayabilir.
The ones who do not understand
yani
can only understand from the words which we speak.
Oradan bir veli geçiyordu zannediyorum, Cüneydi Bağdadi Kadısı Sami Hazretleri.
And a saint was passing through the square where the hangman was. I believe Efendi says he was Hazreti Cüneydi Bağdadi.
İşte görmekte kabus hali olduğu için Hazreti onu gayri irade olarak gördü ve gözlerini kapadı. Ve o asılan adama şefkat nazarıyla baktı. Eyvah, bu adam iyi bir insan olmasaydı, idama mahkum olmasaydı, hayatını gayet de güzel bir normal şekilde geçirseydi ve dünyasını ve ahiretini mamur etseydi, bu fikre sahip olarak şefkat nazarıyla baktı. Fakat gözünü kapadı çünkü çirkin bir hadiseydi, kabus hale gelebilirdi insana.
Although you see this is a ugly sight to look, to see a hanging man, which might deduce from what I have earlier said would bring one a constriction of the heart, a hardening of the heart, but that Shaykh, being in a different level than we are, when he saw this terrible sight, there came a great love and compassion and a sense of mercy, and he wished that men would have led a decent life, a moral life, an ethical life, a life of a faithful servant of God, and looked upon him with the eyes of mercy and compassion.
Çirkin şeylere bakmak gözün afetidir, göz afeti.
It is the sickness of the eye to see the ugly.
Ve bakmak lazımdır.
One should not then see the ugly.
Fakat şeyh görmüştü bunu.
But the şeyh was in a different state.
Ve o gece o zatı rüyada gördüler, o şehrin yani Bağdat şehrinin ileri gelen velileri, hak dostları.
In the city of Baghdad, many of the friends of Allah, many a devout man, many a sheikh dreamt of that hung man that night.
Dediler ki sen kötü bir adamdın, seni mahkeme, cemiyeti senden kurtarmak için senin şerrinden seni astılar, sen bu cennete nasıl girdin dediler.
And all of them saw the criminal in God's paradise. And they were marveled and they questioned him. They said that we know that we have condemned you, that you were a terrible criminal and you have made the whole society suffer. How did you possibly achieve to enter paradise?
Rüyayı bir kişi görmedi.
Not one person dreamt.
40 kişi gördü.
But 40 people did.
O zat dedi ki, ben kötü bir insandım ve cezamı çektim. Bir şeyh efendi geçti oradan, bir Allah'ın dostu velisi bana nazar etti, merhamet nazarıyla. O merhamet nazarıyla nazar etmesinden dolayı beni Allah affetti. Ve dedi ki, kulum, sevdiğim benim sana rahmet nazarıyla baktı. Ben de seni affettim dedi, onun için makama yükseldim dedi.
And the hangman said, indeed, I was a terrible criminal and I was a great sinner. And I have paid with the worldly justice my crimes. But a lover of Allah and a beloved of Allah looked upon me with mercy and compassion. And with this closeness, God has forgiven me and put me in his paradise.
Şakî olarak ölen bir kimseye bir nazarla böyle sait olursa, hayatta yaşayan kimseye bir Allah'ın velisi nazar ederse, yahut kötü bir kimse nazar ederse, elbette nazarının değişir olacaktır.
You see, even a criminal whose acts brought him to execution, with a mere sight of a friend of Allah, of a sheikh, of a wise man, reaches to the heaven of Allah. A devout man, a man who tries to follow the path of Allah, what would happen to him if he would hold the hand of a lover of Allah?
Yeme davasına gelince.
Coming back to the food taken by mouth.
Onun için de bir kısa anlatayım.
Let me tell you a story about that too.
İstanbul'da Şeyh Vefa Hazretleri vardır. Bayezid civarında, Fatih ile Bayezid arasındadır türbesi.
In Istanbul, there is the tomb of a saint by the name of Şeyh Vefa. His tomb is between Bayezid and Fatih.
Bu Şeyh Vefa'nın bir çocuğu vardı. Yani erkek çocuğu dünyaya gelmiş idi. Çocuk 5-6 yaşına vardı. Oynamak için kapının önüne çıktı.
This Shaykh had a young son. He was 5-6 years old. And he went out to the street to play in front of his house.
O devirde İstanbul'da suyu böyle, şimdi buradaki gibi çeşmeler falan yoktu. Sakalar yani, su taşıyanlar. Kırba, hayvan derisini kırba yaparlar. Ondan su taşırlardı.
At those days, clearly there were no running water at certain sections of Istanbul, and water carriers used to carry water in animal skins.
Çocuk bir çivi bulmuş, o çiviyle sakaların kırbasını deliyor ve oradan fışkıran suya ağzını veriyordu.
And the child who wasn't such a well-behaving child had a nail in his hand, and he would go and poke into the skins which contained the water of the water carriers, and then he would put his mouth to the stream of water coming out from the skins and drink.
Ve bu günlerce böyle devam etti.
And this kind of bad behavior continued for quite a while, quite a few days.
Fakat sakalar Şeyh Efendi'ye gelip, senin oğlun böyle bizim kırbalarımızı deliyor diyemiyorlardı. Çünkü çocuğun terbiyesizliğinin manevi mesuliyeti baba ve anne üstündeydi.
And the water carriers couldn't come and complain to Sheikh Vefa because the responsibility, the spiritual responsibility and the moral responsibility of the behavior of children falls on the mothers and the fathers.
Ve bir gün artık sakanın birisinin canına tak dedi. Dedi ki, ben gidip bu çocuğu babasına şikayet edeceğim dedi.
But one day it was one straw too many, and one of the water carriers lost his patience and decided to complain to the sheikh about the little child.
Ya terbiyesini versin ya evine hapsetsin çocuğu.
And he thought that either that child shouldn't behave the way he is behaving, or the child should not come out from the house.
Ve şeyhin huzuruna geldi.
And came to the presence of the şeyh.
Şeyh efendiye niçin geldiğini arz etti. Dedi ki sizin mahdubunuz elinde bir çivi bizim kırbalarımızı deliyor. Şeyh efendi bunun terbiyesini ver çünkü bundan aciz olduk biz.
And they explained what did the child do? That he made holes with the nail in their water carriers, which was their livelihood, and caused a nuisance for them, and asked the sheikh to give a lesson to the young boy.
Ne vakitten beri bu iş böyle oluyor?
And the sheikh asked, since when this has been going on?
Çocuk sokağa çıktığından bu tarafa. Oynamaya çıktıktan bu tarafa. Bunu yapıyor bize.
And the water carrier said, well, since he was permitted to go out to the street to play, beforehand the child didn't used to go out to the street to play.
Niye bana söylemediniz?
Şeyh said, why haven't you told me that before?
Edep ettik size karşı. Terbiyemiz müsait değildi bunu söylemeye ama artık mecbur olduk.
And they said that we know better than that, and that it is not the right way of behaving to come and complain to you about your child. But finally, we couldn't take it anymore.
Ve şeyh dedi ki, kim benden zarar ziyanı varsa gelsin alsın. And yoksa haklar da bana helal etsinler.
And the sheikh said, whatever loss of time and energy and money you have suffered, and anger and feeling of negativity which you have suffered from the behavior of my child, please demand from me and it will be satisfied.
Sonra çocuğu çağırmadı, annesini çağırdı.
Then he called in the mother of the child, his wife.
Düşün, taşın bakayım ne gibi kusur yaptın Allah'a karşı. Allah'ın istemediği bir iş yapmışsın sen.
And said to his wife, please think very carefully of the period till when we have permitted the child to play in the street. You have done something which doesn't please Allah. Could you please think of it and tell me?
Kadın dedi ki ben Allah'ın dediği yoldan hiç çıkmadım.
And the wife responded that I haven't gone out from the ways of Allah, from what is prescribed by Allah.
Hele iyi düşün dedi şeyh efendi.
The şeyh insisted, please think more and try to remember.
Kadın düşündü dedi bir kusurum olarak bunu düşünebiliyorum ben. Bu çocuğa ben hamileydim.
The wife said, well, I have to go further back to seek a fault which I have done, that I was pregnant to your son.
Ve komşuya oturmaya gitmiştim.
And I had gone to visit the neighbor.
Komşu dışarı çıktığı vakitte.
And when the hostess left the room.
Masanın üstünde bir limon gördüm.
I saw half a lemon on the table.
Utandım istemeye limonu.
And I was ashamed to ask permission to take the lemon.
Ve kadınlar hamile olduğu vakitte aşererler yani. Gördükleri yemeye çalışırlar. Ne görürlerse ister canları.
And there is a strange situation with women. When they are pregnant, they have very strange appetites for very strange things. So she had this insatiable, very strong appetite for this half a lemon which was on the table.
Utandım. Onun için limonu kadının haberi olmadan aldım. İğne ile deldim ve ağzımdan emdim.
And when she was out of the room, I took this half a lemon and had a drop of it, just a drop of it.
Ve yerine koydum limonu.
And put it back.
Kadın görmedi bunu.
The woman did not know what I did.
Şeyh dedi, hastalık keşfolundu şimdi.
The sheikh said, finally, thank God, we have discovered the sickness.
Sen dedi, iğneyle limonu deldin, ağzının limonun suyunu verdin. Çocuk ne yaptı? Çiviyle kırbayı deliyor, veriyor suyu. Aynı yapıyor. Ama kalıp değişik yani. Manada bir kalıp değişik. Limon, seninki kırba. Çocuğunki kırba.
You see, he said to his wife, it is the same act. In fact, it's the same imagery. That this drop of lemon which you have sucked from that fruit without asking permission, your son is sticking nails into the skins of the water carriers and drink it from it.
Çaresi nedir?
And what is the cure for that?
Bu hastalıktan kurtulalım, bu manevi hastalıktan. Git kadına de ki ben senin limonunu aldım, iğneyle deldim ve suyundan içtim, bana bunu helal et. Ya parasını vereyim ben onu sana.
So you have to go and find that woman, he said to his wife, and told her the incident that I have sucked a drop of your lemon and ask that she forgives you and she gives that drop of lemon to you. And if she needs, give whatever we must to buy this drop of lemon which you have sucked without her permission.
Kadın gitti ve söyledi. Dedi ki ben bu çocuğa hamileydim. Senin bir limonun vardı burada. Sana sormadan ben o limonu deldim ve emdim. Şimdi onu bana helal et veyahut neyse bedelini istersen bedelini vereyim. Ne yapmam lazım gelirse onu yapayım dedi.
And the woman finally went and found the owner of the lemon and explained her what had happened and begged her to give this drop of lemon juice or if it need be bought, that she was ready to do and to pay whatever she wished.
Kadın dedi, helal olsun, limonun ne kıymeti olur?
He said, what value does a lemon have? Good that you had this drop if you wished.
Çocuğu çağırıp Şeyh Efendi, sen niye kırbayı deldin, niye böyle yaptın demedi.
You see, the Şeyh did not call the child and reprimand him, why have you stuck nails into people's water skins?
Ertesi günü baktılar, çocuk kapının önünde oynuyor. Efendim, sakalar geçiyorlar kırbayla, çocuk çiviyle kırbayı delmiyordu. Yerde çiziyor böyle yerleri, orada oynuyordu.
And next day the child, although he had the same nail in his hand, and there were all the water carriers were passing in front of him, he wasn't touching the water skins at all, but he was drawing little drawings with his nail on the dust.
Onun için çocukların üzerinde bazı çirkin ahlaklar zuhur ederse, bunlar ebeveynin, ananın, babanın yapmış olduğu halin kabız halinin çocuğa geçmesidir.
You see, it extends to the point that sometimes when a child behaves in the manner which our Shaykh told in that story, that is not necessarily the fault of the child, but it is a repayment of what the mothers and fathers have done.
Ha, üçüncüsü dedi ki, sözle dedik. Onda şu cevabını vereyim.
And then I have talked of the words which one listens that may be the cause of this state of hardening of the heart.
Bir putperest delikanlı geçiyordu. Bir deviriş dedi ki, Ya Rabbi bu nasıl, yani bu cezaya çarpar, cehenneme iner bu dedi, bu putperest. Bu kadar güzel yaratmışsın bunu dedi. Bunu söylediği için kendisi diyor ki, 7 sene benim sadrım açılmadı, yani kabus haline kaldım ben.
And there is that very touching story that a dervish, a faithful dervish, watched a very, very handsome, a beautiful creation, a very handsome man passing. But he knew that he was a pagan, he was a fire worshipper. And it passed through his heart. He said, Oh God, you have created him so beautifully, and why have you made him a pagan? And he writes afterwards and says that for 7 years that his heart has hardened because that thought passed through his head and through his heart.
Bir zat geldi, yine aynı şeye, aynı bahse giriyor. Bir zat geldi, Abdullah el-Mubarek namındaki zata. Dedi ki, Hazret dedi, benim dedi çocuğum dedi kötü ahlakı var. Ben bunu ne yapayım dedi. Sordu Hazreti Abdullah el-Mubarek ona. Dedi, sen ona inkisar mı ettin? Kötü sözler mi söyledin inkisardın? Evet. Ha, dedi, işte o, senin sözünün tesiri o dedi.
And Hazreti Abdullah al-Mubarak was visited by a father who came and complained of the state of his little child. And the Shaykh asked to the man, he said, well, have you ever wished bad for your son, that he did something wrong and you wished that he be punished for that? Just the thought passed through your head. And the man said, yes. Well, he said that that's the result.
Yine bir zat geldi mürşidine. Senelerdir ben tesbihat yapıyorum burada, riyaziyat yapıyorum fakat bir türlü benim kabus halinden bas haline geçemiyor, açılmıyor benim göğsüm yani, dedi.
And the student came to his master, and he said, for so many years that I am working and praying and making my duties as a dervish, and still my heart is closed, that I cannot feel the spirit in me.
Şeyh dedi ki ona, sen Allah'ın menettiği yerlere bakıyorsun.
And the Shaykh said, because although with your mouth and with your body, with your heart, you're trying to tie yourself to the Holy Spirit, that your eyes are somewhere else.
O bakman seninle Allah arasına perde oluyor ve kalbin açılmıyor senin.
This sight of yours, he said, becomes a curtain between you and Allah, and you cannot receive him.
Daha bunun daha yüzlerce misalini verebilirim.
There are hundreds and hundreds of examples of this. Yeah.
Onun için başka bahse geçelim, belki bir şeyler daha soracaklar.
Perhaps there are other questions and maybe we should change the subject.
Thank you very much. And as a matter of fact, I had one more question, but you had answered it, because I just wanted to know, when you start picking up this negative thing, these negative things coming into your life, what can you do to turn it around again? If you've done something wrong, and maybe there's no way to make up the wrong that you have done by going to the person and trying to make it right, what can you do just in yourself with your own work to try to turn it around and to get closer to the divine source again?
Aklımda bir sual daha vardı ama bunun cevabını kısmen aldım diyor. İnsan bu gördüklerinden dolayı, duyduklarından dolayı ve Efendimizin izah ettiği şekillerden dolayı kabz haline gelince diyor, bu menfi hal olunca diyor, bundan çıkabilmek için ne yapmalı diyor.
En mühim bir şeydi, derdine deva diyor.
Isn't that so important? You are looking for the cure.
İnsanın başına bir musibet geldiği vakitte, o musibetin nereden geldiğini anlarsa bu bir rahmettir. Eğer musibetin nereden geldiğini anlamazsa ikinci bir musibettir.
If one is troubled, one receives pain and suffering, and if one is not able to find the source of this pain, suffering and trouble, then this is an increased punishment, if you want to, of pain and suffering. It doubles. So one has to seek and find the source where that comes from. And then that's the mercy of Allah if you find it.
Sordular Hazreti İmam-ı Azam'a,
they
paranızın helal olduğunu nereden bilelim diye.
They asked to Hazreti İmam-ı Azam, how are we supposed to know that our sustenance, our money is lawful?
Nereye sarf ediyoruz oradan bilinir dedi.
He said it is very easy. Watch where you are spending it.
onun gibi kabus hali neden geliyor kendisine, bunu keşfedecek, tanıyacak.
So you can seek in this manner also. You see where it comes from and where it goes.
Ben bir gün evvel ne yaptım?
What did I do yesterday?
Ha, onu düşündüğü vakitte buldu mu? Ben bunu böyle yaptım, bundan bu oldu ya, buldu mu? O vakit derdine çare bul demektir.
When you find the connection, when you find the source, then that the mercy has already come to you.
Ondan sonra Allah'a karşı oturur, duaya ve der ki, ya Rabbi, ben böyle bir şey yapmıştım, bundan döndüm, rücu ettim, bir daha yapmamasına söz veriyorum sana der ve kendisini hak ile baş başa bırakır. Hiçbir perde ortaya koymaz. Ne dünyayı ne ahireti. Allah ile baş başa kalır. Ki Allah ona kendinden daha yakındır.
Then you have to turn yourself after having discovered, after you have been conscious of where this source is, then you have to turn towards your Creator and ask forgiveness to Him. But forgiveness is not only asked by words, that it is a contract that should be signed that this will not happen again.
O vakit keşf olacaktır, açılacaktır. Denesin.
Then your heart will open. Try it.
Denesin. Eğer açılmazsa bu radyodan oturalım böyle, bu Şeyh Efendi yalancılısın benim için.
If that doesn't work, you can come to the same station and say that Şeyh is a liar.
Well, thank you, because These are one of the some of the things that people always ask me about in meditation, and one of the things that I was curious about. And it's so incredible sitting here. You know, if this seems all like an accident, you have to know that nothing in the universe is an accident. And one of the strangest things that happened is before I came here, I bought a rose today, and I stuck it in my hair. And when I came up, the Shaykh had a rose in his hand. I've never met him before, and he also had an essence of rose with him. So we're standing in reception, you know, and everybody's smelling of roses. And then I started asking him this question, and that's how I wound up here. So nothing is an accident in the universe. And I'm sitting in here with all these people, and I'm looking at their eyes. Everybody's eyes are so filled with, you know, good feelings and love in here. And I just feel so much better, you know, now that I've been in here and now that I'm leaving. So thank you for this opportunity, and it was nice to meet you, and I'll see you outside. Thank you, Lex.
Diyor ki kainatta hiçbir şey kazaen değil diyor. Bugün sabah diyor bir gül gördüm, saçıma taktım diyor.
Evet.
Yani içeri girdim, bir de baktım Şeyh Efendi'nin evinde elinde bir gül ve gül kokuyor diyor. Sonra bana gül suyu verdi diyor. Şimdi buraya geldik, herkesin yüzü gül diyor, kokusu gül diyor. İçim açıldı, gidiyorum.
Güldür gül.
Efendi says the world is a rose garden.
This is Body, Mind, Spirit. You're listening to WBAI FM. And if this doesn't indicate to you the uniqueness of this radio station, which since it has no script, since it has no very limited human scripts, that some sort of mysterious writings can be known here. The voice that you've been hearing is that of Sheikh Muzaffer Effendi, who's visiting from Istanbul with 30 of his dervishes, and he's been speaking in Turkish, and the translation is by his Western representative Tosun Bayrak, who lives in Spring Valley and has a regular Saturday evening meeting of Western dervishes, and the Sheikh comes to visit once a year from Istanbul. Since we have limited time on the air, and you can see what richness is the stories of the Sheikh have, and this is essentially the way Sufism or the mystical Islam is transmitted through these stories told by the Sheikh. You're all welcome to visit the Sheikh this afternoon from 2:30 to 4:30. He's going to be at the Noor Oriental Gallery, which is at 1 West 30th Street, Suite 201, and all, for those of you who can't come there, many people listening in New Jersey and Connecticut, and you can please give the Sheikh a call this afternoon. And if you have a question, Tosun Bayrak will translate your question, and you make this direct contact with the Sheikh. And the telephone number at the Noor Oriental Gallery is 695-2302. 695-2302. And just mentioning again that Sheikh Muzaffer and his dervishes will be performing the zikr, the ancient ceremony of divine energy, at New York University Tishman Auditorium in Vanderbilt Hall on Monday, March 31st. And there'll be no seating after 7 o'clock, so please get there by 7. And again on April 2nd at 8 p.m., Cooper Union, the Great Hall. And no seating after 7:30 there. And these, of course, these performances are, there's no charge whatsoever for them. It's the generosity of the Islamic tradition which is being poured forth on New York City through the instrument of Sheikh Muzaffer Effendi. And that was Mary Houston, who just, as she said, happened to meet the Sheikh in the reception area of WBAI. And I'm so happy that she came and she asked those questions and the stories flowed from the Sheikh, because this indicates the rose garden quality of our life. There's this kind of enchantment that actually exists in our life if we can open our eyes to it. And it's not a figment of our imagination. Mary Houston happens to be a spiritual seeker in her own quiet way. She doesn't speak about it much on her program. And she, and I'm sure that the stories that the Sheikh told her had some sort of inner connection with her own search, because I saw her nodding in a certain way as if these stories were just for her. And maybe some of you heard them as just for you, and that's the way. That's the way the transmission through a dervish sheikh works. I wanted to ask the sheikh one question too. You heard the story about the dream of the 40 people in Istanbul who happened to have the dream of the man, the condemned man, and the fact that he had been transmitted to paradise through the love and compassion of a great dervish. The medium of dream is something very important in the tariqat, or the order of Sheikh Muzaffer Effendi. And many of us would be very interested in that dream is cherished. The idea of the dreaming faculty is something that's cherished in Sufism and in Islam in general as a real way of revelation and guidance. And Tosin, no need to translate all the intervening things, but we'll, and for that matter, I had a dream about the Sheikh myself this morning, or early this morning, and he explained some of the significance of it to me. This interpretation of the dreams is something that's handed down from the Sheikh to his successor as the head of the order, and it's a very ancient art and a very powerful one. So Tosin Baba, can you just ask Effendi to, in these last 10 minutes that we have, to say something about about the significance of dreams?
Efendiciğim, kalan 10 dakika içerisinde tasavvufta mananın ve mana tabirinin ehemmiyeti hakkında konuşmanızı rica ediyorum.
Hem mühim bir meseleye temas etti.
You have touched an extremely important subject.
Vakit çok dar olmasına rağmen birkaç söz söyleyelim.
Although the time is very restricted, I'm going to tell some truth about them.
Salik, yani talip olan kimse, hak yoluna, Allah yoluna talip olan kimse ve kendinin insanlığını öğrenip ve hak ile ünsiyet etmek isteyen kimse bir mürşide teslim olduğu vakitte ona üç şey teklif edilir.
The seeker, when he finds his master in his search for truth, three propositions are made to him.
Yalan söyleme.
Not to tell lies.
Elinden koymadığın şeyi alma.
Not to take anything which he has placed there by his own hands.
Ve kötülük yapma, gayrimeşru, yani cinsi münasebette bulunma.
And to watch one's activity of flesh, one's sexual behavior.
Tarikat küllül adaptır. Hepsi adaptır. Edep ve adab.
The path of Sufism is all proper behavior.
Onun için bunu üç kelimeyle bağlamışlar. Edep yahu, edep.
They have tied this all together in these three words. O you, behave.
Edebin baş harfi eliftir, eline, ona işaret.
The first word, the first letter of the word adab, of behavior, is alif, a.
And
that
edebin dalı.
And that is symbolic of the hand.
Diline.
And the word, second letter of the word adab is dal, or the letter D. And that is the symbolic of the tongue.
Ve beline, B, edebin B harfi, son harfi B'dir.
And the,
beline, yani gayrimeşru yerlere gitmeyeceksin, sahip olacaksın.
And the last letter of the Arabic word adab is B, and B is symbolic of one's waist, or rather below one's waist, that one has to control that.
Bunu, bu direktifi alır devriş ve şeyhinin onun nasıl ki bir doktor hastasının hastalığını tedavi etmek için bakar, ona göre ilaç verdiği gibi Allah'ın esmalarından esma verir.
Thus, The first lesson and the duty of the dervish is to put that in his mind, to control his tongue, to control his hand, and to control his sex. After that, he is given an appropriate attribute. There are 99 attributes of Allah, and he is given one of these attributes as his, to repeat.
Dervişlik tembellik değildir.
To be a dervish is not to be lazy.
Başıboş yaşamak da değildir.
It is not living free and without responsibility.
Dışı halkla, içi hakla olmaktır.
That the exterior of the dervish has to be with this world, and the interior of the dervish has to be with truth.
Derviş şeyhinin söylemiş olduğu direktifi, hastanın doktorun direktifine uyarak aldığı ilaçlar gibi şeyhinin vermiş olduğu esmaya devam ederse.
If the dervish follows the instruction of the sheikh, as the sick man should follow the instructions and the medicine and the diet of the doctor.
O esmanın esrarı kendisine zuhura gelir.
He will receive the benefit of this esma, the attribute which he was given to repeat.
Mesela gadaplı bir adama şeyhi ya halim esması verir.
For instance, somebody who is angry, his sheikh gives him the esma of Ya Halim, the quiet at heart one, the gentle one.
Yahut gadaplı adam şey Ya Rahman esmasını verir.
Or again, if he was angry, he could receive the esma Ya Rahman, the merciful, the beneficent.
Bunun evveli de tevhiddir ki tevhid bir kılıç gibidir yani.
And then he is, of course, given the tevhid, La ilahe illallah, which is like a sword.
O vakit devriş hemen sınıfını geçer. Eğer şeyhinin dediğini tutarsa sınıfı geçer, derecesi yükselir.
If he follows the sheikh's orders, he evolves and he passes to the next level.
Hasta bir adamın doktorun tavsiyelerine tamamen riayet takdirde nasıl şifa bulduysa o şekilde.
As a sick man, if he follows exactly to the minutest detail the doctor's instruction, would receive health.
O vakit kendisine mana gösterilir manada.
It is only then he starts receiving dreams.
Çünkü artık Allah'la irtibat temin etmiştir.
Then he has a contact with his creator.
Nefse emmaneden geçmek için göreceği rüyalar mavi renkte, çünkü tevhidin nuru mavidir, mavi renkte ve bir takım ağaçlar görür ki bu nefse emmanesinden geçmiştir ve nefsi levameye dönmüştür. Ağaçlık ormanlar görür.
For instance, the sign of passing from the lowest level of ego, which is the flesh, which is all-absorbent, which controls all of you, that the dream signifying that one has passed through that stage to the next stage is that you dream blue dreams and blue forests and blue landscapes.
Şeyh Efendi zaten doktor, hastasının üzerindeki tedavinin tesirini görmektedir.
The Shaykh is able see what is not visible ordinarily to ordinary people in his students.
Salih gördü rüyayı şeyhine anlatırsa,
when the student tells the dream which he has seen to his master,
ve anlatması da lazımdır,
and he must,
başkasına söyleyemez,
and he must not tell it to anybody else,
esması değiştirilir ve derecatı maneviyatı yükselir.
Then his level, spiritual level, is raised, and then his lesson, for instance, the esma, the attribute which was given to him to repeat, is changed to another one.
Ve 7 derecedir zaten, 7 sınıftır yani.
There are 7 such levels.
En akali 3 sene, en fazla 12 senedir.
And the evolution from these 7 levels is minimum 3 years and maximum 12.
her derecatta rüya ile şeyhi onun esmasını değiştirerek.
And in each dream, if it is significant, the şeyh changes the level and the lessons.
Vasılıyla Allah eder.
And finally, şeyh helps him, takes him by hand and brings him to Allah.
Bu mühim bir bahistir. Böyle 10 dakikada, 15 dakikada söylenecek, anlatılacak gibi değil. Ama ancak bu kadar söyleyebildik.
As with the sample you have seen, that it is such an immense subject, that that's all what I can say in the 10 minutes.
Rüya meselesine girince, rüya nedir diye sorulursa, madde yoktur, göz yoktur, gören nedir ve görülen nedir?
A dream, there is no eye, there is nothing to be seen, so who is seeing and what is being seen?
Öyleyse gösteren var rüyayı.
Thus somebody is showing you something and giving you something to see it with.
Nitekim ki cümle enbiyaya vahiy evvela rüya ile başlamıştır. Rüya-i sadıkayla.
To all the prophets, the first revelations came through dreams.
İbrahim peygamberin vesaire Musa peygamberin gördüğü rüyalar ve bunlar da hepsi Kur'an'da ve diğer kitabı semaviyede mukayyettir.
That in the books all this is written, what all the prophets have dreamt.
Bunları böyle dereceli anlatmak isterdik ama vakitimiz tamam oldu zannediyorum.
I believe the time is up.
You've been listening to Sheikh Muzaffer, who has just compressed an amazing amount of truth into ten minutes and into the whole hour, actually. Please continue the conversation. You can call right this afternoon, 695-2302. That's the Noor Oriental Gallery. Come this afternoon and visit the Sheikh, or come when his dervishes and he perform the zikr. And you can find information at this telephone number, too. Sheikh Muzaffer, thank you so much.